Oh, you're waiting on me? Did you get me going to the bathroom? All right. All right. What's up, everybody? What's up, everybody? Not a good start. So I had this idea when I was in Helen about starting to do some live streams and talking about, you know, some of the specific products that we do. You know, audio was the first thing that popped into my head, pressure washing, and do some more like sales events where I'm kind of hanging out with you guys live, being able to answer questions. So Chris is over here monitoring questions, and then hopefully the byproduct is selling some product. The other reason I wanted to do this is, you know, in full transparency, we didn't have the manpower when I started this business to do like real inventory, where we would actually look at what were our sales, and you know, how many products should we order, and so with audio, I just started ordering stuff. With Milwaukee, started ordering stuff. And so we were revamping the warehouse next door. We doubled our capacity, a little bit more than double our capacity. And so I've got all these giant heavy boxes that it would be nice to kind of sell a bunch of it and then restock it after we, you know, get the shelf set up. So we came up with this idea as a group and said, you know, we need to start doing some live stream private sale events. And combine that with the fact that we're probably headed to recession, I'm gonna have to work a little harder to provide you more value than what we already do, and kind of reinvigorate some products. And like with audio, it makes a lot of sense to me because it's so complicated. You know, it's a harder thing to buy than just buying a detail spray or something like that. So we're gonna do old school like I used to do in a showroom, and this makes me wanna buy like a house and build a showroom so I can do this more often. But like old school sound advice days back in my younger days, where I would stand in a demo room, play some music, talk about what I'm hearing, talk about you know, speakers and audio equipment. And we're going to do this top down. They used to call this top down selling, where you would start at the highest, most expensive thing and kind of work your way down, and you kind of look people in the eye and figure out where they, you know, where the glimmer came from. You talk about price and talk about value, and then, you know, let people make an educated decision on what they think is valuable to them. And so I'm gonna do the same thing to you and kind of take you through all the different equipment, talk about how to hook it up, talk about cabling. We'll get into subwoofers. We'll also get into wireless subwoofers and talk about stuff. And I'm mainly discussing the garage. That's what I'm going to lead with, and then Chris will kind of interject if you have questions about home theater, because all of this stuff can apply to office audio, garage, you know, not just garage, but office, stereo, if you have a, you know, two-channel setup, your desk setup, you could do Core 59s in a home theater setup. We can talk about how to do that. If you have a dedicated home theater, family room home theater. And we're going to get into today. We're going to talk specifically studio monitors. And then once our next event, Friday at 2 p.m., will be stereo. So it'll be traditional passive speakers with like amplifiers. So this isn't an amplifier, it's just a preamplifier. And then on the 9th, which would be next Tuesday at 5 p.m., we're going to get into wireless stuff like PSB AM5s. And so we'll dig into that stuff. If there's overwhelming questions about that, I can answer that tonight. But explain to me, Brad, how this is working for people. We can't publish. I don't want to publish sale prices. And I'm really only doing this to, you know, I don't know, because I think it'd be fun and try to convince people to come buy some stuff while we're doing this live. But we're running a specific sale. So how do people find that out? They can click the link at the top of the comments, right?
Yeah,
that's for open box. We have some open box stuff.
Box sheet, and they can email support@obsessgarage.
Okay.
If they can hear me, support@obsessgarage. And then we also have a collection full of a lot of our audio equipment, and that's going to be 20% off for the duration of this live stream. So you can get the audio stuff that we have on the shelf, or you can get the open box stuff that we're messing with right here. And so if you want the open box stuff, just email us, support@obsessgarage. Nick and I we're right here. So
that open box list is at the top of the comments.
Yes.
And then email support@obsessgarage.com. Nick and Brad and Chris are all monitoring it right now. So if you have questions or you want to purchase, you can do that now.
Right.
Or you can go to the website, click on the link?
Yep. We have an audio collection on the private audio sale landing page. Okay. So you'll click that link. It says View Collection.
Can they click like the Core 59 package?
They can.
Okay.
They can.
And so those packages are on sale
yep.
just tonight. Then we're going to run this for the next, you know, for the next week as we do these events.
Right.
You just have to email us. So we're going to make that collection live and unlive. So I just don't want to violate any rules. I can have private events as long as we're not publicly, you know, publishing pricing. Really, I just want to do this to kind of drum up some interest, get more audio systems in people's garages because I think it's magical. So anyway, let's get into this. Let's get started. So I'll come back. So we'll do that remind me to do that two or three times.
Sure.
To come back and remind people, because people will come into the live stream as we're going on here, of how to go and get a deal. So email support@obsessedgarage.com, and they'll respond to you right now.
When it comes through those questions, you answer since you mic'd up.
Okay.
Yeah, go first.
Got it. So we're going to start at the top. And so this is the system that I have in Helen. This is the system I had in my home garage. This is the system, actually, these are the Core 59s from my house. This is the system that we have here at HQ. So I must like this more. Now, in the Harbor Hills house, I did high-end bookshelves and M33 stereo amplifier, so I did it passively. This I would call actively, and the reason why we call this active is because these speakers have an amplifier. So there's a Class D, Pascal Class D, super high quality, super efficient amplifier. If you take a look at the back of, say, the Core 47, you can see this brick on the back of it. And so these speakers are designed for recording studios. In my normal fashion, you know, I want to repurpose things that are for professional environments. I mean, think about the darn Krenzel pressure washers designed for meatpacking plants, chicken hatcheries, food processing areas where they can't do gas inside, so they need a high flow electric. And so these speakers are designed for near field listening. Be careful of my expensive tweeter here. When I say near field, they're designed for you to be in a studio with a pair of speakers. So let's say I had a mixing board here. I had a pair of speakers in a soffit or maybe on a pair of stands behind my mixing board. And I have those speakers, you know, 2-3 feet from my ears. So the magic of these for the garage, you know, the garage is such a terrible listening environment. The magic of these studio monitor type speakers that are designed for close listening is they're just more controlled. Combine that with my love affair of Dynaudio's tweeter, and you've got yourself a magical combination. So I just keep coming back to these. You know, especially, you know, these three, the Core series, we're going to talk about LYDs, which are a little more practical as we go from top down. But Core stuff is, the finish is perfect for a garage. The setup, especially, I think these two are perfect for putting on top of your cabinets, which is not ideal, but again, we're working with a garage here, working with what we have, and generally have an array of cabinets, and so putting them up high, they do really well with that. These horizontal type speakers, and you get more amplitude than you can handle. I mean, I've never turned these up as loud as they go. I mean, you just can't. You can't stand it. I mean, they'll play 125 dB, something like that. The 59s, these are somewhere around 115, and then you know you can still get quite a bit of amplitude out of the Core 7s. So, when you're building a system for your garage, you start with. I start with speakers, but you also need a source. So you need a source component. And part of the reason why I got turned on to this whole concept here of you know, streaming and digital analog conversion, part of what I wanted to do was eliminate the need to have some sort of plug-in source. I also wanted to eliminate Bluetooth. You know, if I'm gonna spend $6,000 on a pair of speakers, I don't want to be running, you know, Bluetooth Pandora, you know, at sub-CD quality, you know, if you're going to spend all this money. So we have a terrible listening environment. I mean, this our yarn building isn't a great listening environment either, but we have this terrible, you know, garage where you have glass in your car, you have metal, you have concrete, you have a metal garage door a lot of times. And so I think you need something that I would prefer to have something that's very subdued, very smooth, very, and very simple, hopefully. I don't want a bunch of equipment, I don't want a bunch of wires, so I want to keep it as simple as possible. So let's talk about Core 59s, and then we'll kind of work our way down and we'll play these for you as well, for whatever that's worth. Let me just pull my plug out here and show you what we're doing here. So because the amplifier is here, we're going to use a preamplifier. And I'm telling you, if you're going to spend, these are $3,000 a piece. These are $2,000 a piece. Wait. Yeah, $3,000, $2,500, $2,000 is what the retail price are on these puppies. If you're going to spend that much money on a pair of speakers, buy the, how much is a C658? Can someone look that up real quick for me? I think it's $1,200, something like that. Oh, no, I think it's $1,600.
$2,000?
Okay. So $19.99 for a C658 versus a Node. So you'll notice the beauty of this, I have one cable. So one XLR cable, one analog input, and then my power cord isn't long enough to reach, but I have a power cord. So theoretically, the way you set this up, you put your source component somewhere, put it on the top of your closet or the top of your biggest cabinet. If you're going to build a garage, you know, we can run some XLRs through the wall, but you only need one cable, so one wire and one plug. So if we were going to, again, you were going to pre-wire your garage, you'd put a power outlet wherever you're going to put your speaker. So a power outlet for each speaker, just to make it simple. Because this is Class D amplification, a single 15-amp circuit, even a muddy circuit with some other stuff on it, I think you'll be fine. So then the thing I like about these most is their, you know, these have Dynaudio's, you know, one of the, you know, I think this is a variant of the tweeter that's in the Contour 60 range, which is their second down, second from top, floor standing and home theater and the stereo speakers. But the Dynaudio tweeter silk dome. There's ribbon tweeters, there are metal dome tweeters, beryllium tweeters, there's all different types of tweeters. But I like the simplicity and the sound signature, the smoothness of Dynaudio. So you take that combined with the DSP in this affords me the ability to run it as what they call dark. So when I'm running it in the garage, I run it dark. So you have bright, neutral, and dark. Running it dark combined with a really smooth silk dome tweeter, what it does is knocks a dB and a half off the upper frequency range, off of 20K, so 15 to 20,000 hertz, so it knocks a dB and a half off of it and adds a dB and a half to the bass, to the lower frequency, to kind of bring or kind of shift the sound signature a bit. So I can run this sucker in super smooth silk dome, but also lighten it up even more just out of the box just by clicking the button on the DSP. So these I plug in, I set my sensitivity settings and my SPL output settings, basically max out my sensitivity, max out my SPL setting, and I'm going to run it as anechoic, which means just open air. I'm going to run it as, let me try to have the right speaker, and I'm going to run it in a dark setting in the free position. They also have some DSP settings if you had it close to a wall or a corner or something like that. So you would have these. It take you longer to get it out of the box than it will to set it up. That's what's so cool about this. And so Core 59s, and if you money no object, you're watching this video, you're saying, Matt, what should I get for my garage? I'm a baller. I got tons of cash. I love audio. I value audio. What would you buy? I would probably say this. I can get any speaker I want for the garage. I've got three different garages now, and I'll tell you that I have these in all three of them. And I always get in trouble. You're always yelling at me about doing the same thing. You're always doing the same thing, man. Same thing. Don't you get bored? Well, there's one best way to do it, and I just keep going back to this. And I only have three garages. I don't have 13 garages. If I had 13, I'd probably do some different things, but I just love these so much. They're just amazing, magical. So single 1-inch tweeter, 4-inch mid-bass driver, a 9-inch low frequency driver. So clearly you could run this on its own. We'll get into subwoofers at the end here, but you could run this by itself. And believe it or not, it's designed so the tweeter woofer combo goes on the outside when you're setting up a stereo pair like this, not on the inside. So it's kind of counterintuitive. To me, I think it would make sense to bring the tweeter in, but they recommend running the tweeter on the outside. This speaker is also available. You can run it. So when it comes, it's set up vertically. So this device or this section of the speaker can turn. So you can run it in a vertical environment if you had a different sort of setup. You want to put it on some stands next to your cabinet. You wanted to run it in your office or something like that. So the other cool thing about these is the finish. The finish is pretty darn nice. And they have a post. Will the camera reach over to the garage here just to show them how they set it up? So in here, you can see they sell a very specific bracket. And so you could take, so Core 7s, Core 47s, and the Core 59s all can use that same bracket. We stock those brackets as well. So if you wanted to mount it on the wall and get it up off the cabinet, my sonic array is not deep enough to hold the speaker. And so putting it on that helps decouple it from the cabinets and gives me the option to wall mount it. So we set ours up there. So then my source component looks like this. I've got two wires coming out of the back of it. I've got power. And I've got left and right. You have your Bluetooth and your Wi-Fi antennas. And we're really not going to use any inputs here because I'm going to simply run Tidal through the BlueOS app on this puppy. So NAD owns Blue Sound or something like that. So they're all owned by Lenbrook. I'm not sure what the relationship is there exactly. But all NAD equipment comes equipped with either the option to add BlueOS or it comes on board with BlueOS. So this C685 is a Dirac capable, meaning it has full room calibration software capability. You spend, I think it's like $200, you can buy a license and you can do room calibration. I've actually done, this one is from my garage in there, and so I did a full Dirac, you know, multi-position room calibration. And then this, you know, clearly the processor in here, the circuitry in here is spread out, and hopefully there's more high quality components inside of a larger device like this. So you would think something like this would sound better. But there's no amplification going on here. What we're doing is this becomes the native digital analog converter. So when I'm using my remote or my phone, or I'm using the BlueOS app, this app, so you can see, let me go here. So here's the BlueOS app. I could run Tidal or Spotify or Apple Music or whatever I'm using, and it will recognize the C685. I'm showing you all my dirty laundry here. So let's say I'm playing Chris Williamson episode here.
During which trade and industrial activity,
I could then generally identify, see my 685 right there, so I could AirPlay it right to our C685 instantly, just like that. And I mean, you can set it, you'd set this thing up in a minute. It'll generally have you do a software update, so maybe it takes 5 minutes. But I can run AirPlay, I could run Bluetooth, or I can run native. And so if I go back and run my BlueOS app, there's my C685 sitting there, and I can run native software or native playback through Tidal. So I can select Tidal. Actually, there was, I hit the wrong button. So if I go back to Tidal, and then I have my music, let me just play something. So the magic of this, if you'll notice here, so I'm connected. Now you can argue back and forth about MQA. So MQA is a 24-bit, 192 kilohertz. It's technically not lossless, but I'm able to connect natively. So this becomes the remote control. This is the player. Versus if you're using Bluetooth or AirPlay, you're using this as the player, and then this device is just, you're doing a conversion, a digital, and then sending out the analog signal through the XLR cables. So the best way to do this and to make it simple, seamless, you'd want to get yourself a Tidal or Spotify subscription, turn up to the highest resolution capable, and you want to use a player like this C685, especially if you're using these, and you're able to then get full high-res audio and listen to whatever the heck you want. You know, anything you can dream of is probably on, you know, Tidal and Spotify. Tidal being higher quality than Spotify. Spotify is, I think their high-res is, 320 kilobits per second, where I don't know what the conversion from MQA to kilobits per second is, but the quality, the resolution of Tidal, I think, is best. There's also Cobuzz, which I haven't spent a lot of time with. And then Apple Lossless is great. The problem with Apple Lossless is there really is no way, especially through Blue OS yet, I'm sure there will be in future software updates, but there's no way to get Apple Lossless to your device without doing some sort of USB, you know, that some guys have told me there's a way to do it where you have to connect it wired. But for the time being, I want it simple. I want to walk around my garage. I want to play whatever the heck I want to play. So let's play a couple things here, and I'll tell you what I hear when I hear these speakers, what I'm listening to. So we didn't monetize this. We'll see. Hopefully we don't get some sort of copyright strike, but I'm just going to play the music that I like. And I'm obsessed with this song recently. Jeff's heard me play it about 500 times, but White Stripes, Ball and Biscuit. And so what you'll hear on a set of Core 59s over maybe some of the others, there really isn't a significantly greater frequency response. So you're not going to get a whole lot more bass. Certainly not going to get any more treble, if that's what you're interested in. What you're going to get with Core 59s over 47s or 7s is just more output, more amplitude. And so I'm just buying it because I can. But you're not going to hear much of a difference between the speakers because they all have the same tweeter. They all have the same amount of amplification per driver, 500 watts for the woofers and 250 watts for the tweeters, I believe is how it's set up. And it's, I believe it's a true, you know, RMS 500 watts per channel. And then each driver has its own dedicated channel for it. But what you're going to hear with these speakers is just pure clean, pure smooth. Not a lot of extra going on. And the magic of these, I can play at high volumes and not have a fatiguing, it doesn't fatigue me. So no subwoofer. Might help if I plug this one in. So these will signal sense. So you notice red light. As soon as I hit play, turn to green, take a second, and now we're on. Thought it sounded a little weird there. By the way, I left Sound Advice in 2004 to go to Merrill Lynch. I always thought someday I'll get back to audio. And so this is what stuff that dreams are made out of for me, man. And then to have Dyn Audio allow me to do this, NAD, it's incredible. So one of the other real huge advantages to this particular system is the ability to do a room calibration. And so right out of the box, it sounds pretty good, but you'd be surprised. It's magical what they'll sound like if you do a, you know, multi-position room calibration on whatever, you know, whatever your setup is. Generally what I'll do is run them. A lot of people say that speakers don't break in. You know, I'd always assumed they did, but I think that may be an old wives' tale that like speakers warm up over time. any, you know, old school audiophile you talk to, maybe older drivers did, but I feel like speakers smooth out over time. They soften up a bit as they, you know, as they break in. And so I like to run the speakers for say 50 or 100 hours before I do a calibration. I do the same thing with the TV, but that may be placebo. I'm not really sure. But I listen to a lot of this kind of stuff. This is Maynard James Keenan, the guy who from Tool. This is Pussifer, one of his bands. He has three bands: Perfect Circle, Tool, and Pussifer are the three bands. I think he has one other one too. But I listen to a lot of this kind of stuff where it starts out as simple, whiny, and then turns into something that makes me want to punch the air, you know, that kind of stuff. This is one of my favorite songs of all time, called Green Valley.
No direction but to trust the final destination. You're a stranger till she whispers you can stay. You're a stranger till she whispers.
So in the garage, like I'm using the volume control here, we never touch this thing. Its signal senses turns on as soon as you open the app, turns off on its own, you never have to touch it. Here it comes.
Majesty, the Verde River. Way the before her, Majesty, the Verde River.
So beautiful. So my volume, I can adjust my volume right here. Same thing as I'm kind of searching through my music. The mixes in Blue OS are better than the mixes in the native Tidal app. And so these are like all my favorite songs that I've saved. But then I can control it down here as well by controlling my volume while I'm scrolling through what I want to listen to next. I'm telling you, so in Helen, we set up the full 8 zones of audio. I have this in the garage. There's nothing like Blue OS. It's the best system on the planet at the moment for digital stuff. What do you got?
All right, we got a couple questions here from people in the chat. So we'll start with the Core 47. Frank L. wants to know, is the amp setup the same in the Core 47 versus Core 59?
Yeah, so take a look here. So if we take a look at the back, I'm gonna unplug the speaker here. So the amplifier is identical in 47, 59, and for, you know, so 47, 7, and 59. So this amp is the same. If you take a look at the Core 7, same exact amplifier. The only difference is the amount of channels in this. Obviously, this has two internal channels to drive each speaker independently. So same setup. So I think, check the specs on this. Check this, Jeff. I'm pretty sure it's 250 watts for the tweeter, 500 watts for each woofer, and I think it's the same on the 59. So if that's the case, I think so if you go to specifications, where are we at? Yeah, go to DynAudio's site. Just to, and then let's go to the Core stuff. So the 47 is a lot more practical. I mean, look at the size difference, the size and weight. And then it's easier to fit this on top of your cabinets. And if you're going to run it with a subwoofer, I mean, the difference is, you know, is minimal. Difference is substantial in price over these $6,000 a pair versus $5,000 a pair, is $1,000. You're getting the same level of amplification, same sound signature. So if we look here, 1-inch, 5-inch, 9-inch, and then 150, 500, 500. Okay, so it's 150, not 250. Now go to the 47. Tech specs. So 1-inch, 4-inch, 7-inch, 150, 500, 500. So technically speaking, the 47 from an amplification perspective is going to be a superior speaker. You've got a smaller, so you got a 7-inch instead of a 9-inch, and you have a 3-inch instead of 4-inch, I think. Yeah, 3-inch instead of 4-inch. And so this has 500 watts, that has 500 watts. This has 500 watts, that has 500 watts. The tweeter's identical. So, you know, the 47 is a good, I'm gonna call it a bargain, but the 47 would connect just the same setup, same everything as a 59. Other questions?
All right, from Solarplex Studios. I need advice on what is the best new studio monitor speakers for my studio update if I have a budget of $6,000.
I think I'd want a subwoofer with, I'd probably do Core 7s, which are $4,000 a pair, and then I would do a sub 18S, which is $1,800. And then he'll probably have, so you'll probably have digital connection, so you'll probably run it with your mixing board. You'll come out and go a digital XLR in. So you need, I forget what they call this, it's like AES or something like that, it's the type of connection. So in your actual studio, you would run the digital in connection from your mixing or soundboard. But yeah, I would probably want Core 7s in that price point, you know, if you're, you know, around $6,000 for your setup. So you do that, and then this subwoofer right here. So I would rather have that than 59s. So I'd rather have 40, so I'd rather have 7s and a subwoofer than 59s standalone, personally. I think if you're gonna buy 59s standalone, run them for a little while and then get the subwoofer later. Especially, you know, in a recording studio, and not as much, but certainly in a garage, you got a lot of space. You know, I think you want that. Bass just makes it fun. What you're hearing here is Florida torrential downpour.
All right, our friend Travis in Louisiana says, is there an audio package that Matt had on the SVS videos with a PB1000 and two speakers plus blue sound node and cables?
There may be in the future. Okay. So SVS doesn't want us packaging things for now, and so it'd be a subwoofer add-on. We'll get into subwoofers in a few minutes here about how to, you know, how to connect the subwoofer to this. I'm gonna show you in a few minutes here, show you wired. And then we'll get into wireless options at the end of the video here, or the end of the live stream.
All right, then let me switch gears on you for just a second. This is from Liam in the chat. For a basic entry-level home theater setup, would I be better off with a PSB AM5s or PSB P5s with the power node?
Give me the choice again. So,
better off with PSB AM5s or PSB P5s with the power node?
I think always, because you'd have more amplitude, I would want a power node in P5s. You know, the amplifier in the power node is far superior to the amplifier that's in the AM5s, which is very different than, like, these speakers. The amplifier in this is just as good as the amplifier in some of the, you know, standalone NAD stuff. Other questions before I kind of...
No, go ahead.
Okay. So with cores, so you get the idea. So it's simply more amplitude. The frequency response isn't a big selling point. So I think it comes down to the difference between the 7s and the 47s. I think it comes down to price and how the orientation is. These you wouldn't run horizontally. They only run vertically. So you wouldn't run these in a, you know, turned over. I mean, I guess you technically could. But you wouldn't want to. If you're going to put those on the bracket that we showed over there, you'd want to put the bracket here. You know, you want to put the bracket where the speaker stays upright. The, you know, I think it just comes down to size and money on these. You know, how much money you got and how much room do you have. And so, but from a output perspective, I'm always going to suggest go less on the speaker and add a subwoofer. You know, forego the speaker for the subwoofer. So if you're buying 59s or 47s and you want to do the ultimate setup, this is your guy. This is one of my favorite audio pieces of equipment on the planet. So this is a Core subwoofer. So what it is nine inch woofers. These are clearly very different woofers, even just pushing on them, than what's in like the Core 59. So these are high excursion, high output, sealed enclosed subwoofer. Plays down to, I think, 16 hertz. So you want to make sure you have a system that's capable of playing that low frequency response, and it has four of them. So there's two more on this side. No port, sealed. It actually does really well putting it up close to, like, I put it up close to my cabinet like this. It actually does really well that way. And so this is a $4,000 subwoofer. And you can stack these on top of one another. Now in my garage here, I'm running two of them. So one on each side of the cabinet array. This subwoofer is a change of life. And so the way to hook this up, sorry for my cable mess here, but we have, just like the speakers, I have analog in and I plug it in. Super, super simple. So I have a 4 meter cable here, so let me just plug it in the back. Now, the C685, as well as the node, they don't have a XLR out. So what I'm doing is I'm taking this little pigtail here. I'm gonna go subwoofer out here. This has two subwoofer connections. Now, the subwoofer out is not discrete on this. I don't know if you can see it. So there's sub one and sub two. It's not, meaning that you can't adjust them independently in the software. It's just basically you're running it. So I'm running two subwoofers next door, and I'm just running them the same. You know, so they're, when I'm tuning the system, it's just the Dirac microphone is picking up where the subwoofer is and then doing whatever room calibration based on that. And so all I'm gonna do then is I'm gonna take, a 4 meter XLR cable, like so. I'm gonna plug it in to my RCA out, and I'll plug it into the analog input of the subwoofer. And I'll show you some of the settings on there. My cable go right here. Like this. And I'm done. By the way, these are all Metra XLR cables. I like these a lot. Pretty inexpensive. And then generally I'll run the subwoofer as full bandwidth, free, anechoic, meaning open air. I'm gonna run zero attenuation, 0 dB. I'm gonna run it, this doesn't matter because that's for the digital input. And I'm gonna run it at input sensitivity of zero and SPL of 12. So I'm running it max output, and then I'm doing my subwoofer sort of volume control through the Dirac software when I do the calibration. But this sucker will change the whole sound characteristic. Now, what I need to do in my NAD, my Blue Sound software, I need to turn the subwoofer on. So now I have the subwoofer on. By the way, here's my Dirac calibration. I have it five position with flanking subs. So that allows me to do the, if you ran a bunch of different tunes, like you could run like a rock tune, a classical tune, you could run some different tunes and they'd all show up here in the software. Right now I have one subwoofer and I'm not gonna run my Dirac calibration because that's for the room next door. So that's how that would look. And then if I play the same thing, let's get you a different song. I'm a big fan of, I'm starting to get into, I guess it's like Carolina country, but without the twang nonsense. So this company is called the Marshall King Band that I've been listening to a lot recently. Let me plug the speaker back in. Katie Bell's made an appearance. We'll have to interview them. My subwoofer turns on. Green light. So think about this. In your garage, you would have this set up, and as quick as you can run the cables and open the boxes, it's three cables. Three cables, three power cables. Super simple. Blue OS app, done. So notice the woofer difference, the surround. This is not a high excursion, you know, bass specific woofer. The woofer on these Dynaudio subwoofers is very different. It was such a pleasant surprise. I didn't know I would love them as much as I do. This song is great. Marshall King Band. I call this Montana country, real man country, not that twangy nerd crap. I don't listen to country, but apparently I'm starting to like this stuff. You know what we should do? Let's hook up our... seconds, I can switch speakers. Full, dark. This is the right speaker. Anechoic, free, zero sensitivity. I feel like the Core 59s are a little more open sounding. Now these have probably 400 hours on them. These are brand new out of the box. So I don't think the Core 47s are spoken for, so I needed to open it up for this video. So they've been played for about 30 seconds and I have the boxes and everything. So these would be 25% off, you know, demo pricing. Where are you guys going? Look who it is. KB, you gotta say hi to the people. You gotta ask them to buy some speakers.
They're selling these?
Yeah, what do you think about this, Ryan? You got any input on audio equipment?
These for my PC.
They actually would work, but no.
So expensive.
What about you? Do you want these for your playroom so you can do some dancing?
No.
You just listen to the audio on this, don't you? So my children listen to music on their phone and...
AirPods.
Ryan just got a phone. And Kate on her iPad with that junk speaker. These are my children. Like they.
No, I listen to AirPods.
Yeah. Yeah, and Michelle listens on the speakers on the Mac speakers.
You gotta give me one of these.
And you have to want it.
I want the white one.
Like I'm not giving these to any of these people that are watching this live stream.
Like
you have to want this. You should want. Everybody should want this.
Can I get that white one?
I don't.
No. You can't get any of them.
Can I get the cheapest one?
You've got to get them. You got to want them.
You have to buy them.
I do. Put them on your Christmas list, kids.
Yeah.
So,
do we want to... So, Ryan has how many hours do you have to work off still? He was at 92 hours for his phone. He got his first phone.
Hours.
So, he has 89 hours left.
I did three.
Yeah, but you didn't really do three. You laid like an hour and a half.
No, I did three.
Grandma gave you extra credit.
No, I did three.
So 89 hours left?
86.
So those would take another like 90 hours or so?
What? Those are...
Yeah, yeah. What are you guys doing tonight? Just dropping by?
We came to say hi.
How are you going to get out of here? It's pouring down rain.
Oh, it's pouring.
Chris, any other questions?
Yes, James wants to know which source unit or units are those. Is that?
Say that again?
James in the chat wants to know what source unit is that.
Yeah, this is the Dynaudio, or I'm sorry, NAD C685 preamplifier. The one on top, which we're not using yet, we're going to use that when we do the LYD stuff, is a Blue Sound node. So we'll transition to that. So the node is, so this is $2,000, the node is $900, $1,000. So it's half the price. But, you know, not, this doesn't have any Dirac room calibration or anything. I think if you're doing cores, you're buying either a core sub with them or a sub 18S. So this is the, basically this is a core sub and a half. So one half of a core sub. So this is the, you know, the timber match. There's a DSP in here that allows it to connect directly actually run. So the DSP is set up so that it crosses over exactly where you'd want it to. So DynAudio did a lot of room calibration stuff to make this thing work seamlessly with cores or LYDs, which are the other ones we're going to get into in a minute. Other questions?
One Sunny Day wants to know, what do you do when you also install a TV? Do you use the same
good
source?
Question. So he was asking about a TV, right? Gosh, this rain is junk. So, if you're doing a TV, let me just unplug this just so you can see. Just so I can flip this around for you. So, the way to do it would be to, God dang, it's like torrential tornado out here. So, the way to do it would be you'd run, let's say you had a smart TV, you had a TV set up. So that TV will have an audio return channel output, or ARC, A-R-C. It'll also, if you bought a new TV, it'll probably have E-ARC. So on the C685, there's a module, it's $350, and you just keep adding on price to you. But the module is what allows you to do, it adds video. So this MDC module, you take this cover off, you put the module in, it has three inputs and one output. And so you would run the audio return channel from your TV back to this. I use Apple TVs. And so what you want to do on your Apple TV, run it out of the Apple TV, into the back of here, out of here, into your TV. And so you just run a couple HDMI cables. We have those as well. We also have these modules too. And so if you were going to do it with the node, you'd have to use ARC only, right? And so you'd run the Apple TV to your TV input, and then there's usually like output three or input three, you would then have an HDMI cable connect to the ARC connection. E-ARC allows it to pass lossless Dolby audio, Dolby Digital, Dolby Atmos, all of that stuff. Now these would just be stereo, but you could run, you know, PCM, pulse code modulation, high res, lossless audio, right from your TV into either one of these devices and play it through the speakers. I have the same thing at my house here at Darlington. We had set up that way, and then the Helen house, we're using the ARC connection with the C685 and the HDM2 module, which is the HDMI module for this. So you could use these speakers in a video setup very easily as well. Super simple. You can switch it from the app. Or you can switch it from the, from the front of this, the source input here. Other questions before we jump into the next?
Well, a question from Ethan Burfitt. The guys address it, but it'll be a good segue here. I'd love to get the best, but I can't right now.
Yep.
Will there be setups just like pressure washer with good, better, best?
Yes.
Basic, advanced, ultimate. That's
good thing you asked that. So cores are the ultimate, right? Cores are what you aspire to own. I think that this is the best. I mean, you can do better, but for what, you know, the systems that I'm putting together, I mean, you can spend an infinite amount of money. But for what I'm suggesting, my ultimate setup is some version of cores, a core sub or two, and a C685. But you're talking about systems that are, you know, $10,000 plus. You know, this is for the, you know, the affluent, the people that just really value audio and have tons of cash. So let's give us a minute here and let's swap over to the LYDs and a node and talk about some more practical systems. Remember, I was gonna start at the top and we'll work our way down. So let's move these out of the way, guys, and we'll come back in a second. Other questions while we're kind of doing this, Chris?
Yes. I think this this gets down to the lower one, but I ask it anyway. What's the difference between the PSD AM3 and AM5 that justifies the price difference?
It's bigger, more amplification, and a bigger woofer. The tweeter's the same 3/4-inch tweeter, but the amplifier is, the woofer's bigger, the cabinet's bigger. The AM3s are like, they're like this big. They're like tiny. AM5s are like more like a normal bookshelf speaker. So AM5s, I think, are 100% of the way to go. It's worth every penny. Much, much better speaker than the AM3. AM3s will surprise you, but you know, if you have a choice, you're not going to choose that.
All right, Jason Taylor says, I have a Sennheiser soundbar. I'm told a subwoofer added will be perfect.
I would hold off because Sennheiser's coming out with a subwoofer soon. You didn't hear that from me. Oh, shoot, that's live. I don't know, crap.
Is an Ambio soundbar. That's the one you like.
So, by the way, we are an Ambio dealer, so we're going to be ordering those here soon. I'm hoping this audio sale affords me the ability to buy some Ambios. That soundbar is incredible. And I think that's going to be a really awesome solution for the garage. If you haven't want a simple setup with a TV, it's going to be the way to go.
Here's a question you like. We actually have a lady watching. Millie says, we're building a home.
Yep.
My husband has so many ideas from watching you on YouTube.
Okay.
But it's kind of expensive. She then follows up, sorry to sound stupid, but why would you want a TV and audio in the garage?
Well, I would use a TV a lot more, but I'm always videoing, right? But I use audio all the time. You know, when you're hanging out in the garage, there's something magical about having great audio in the garage. Great video is not as dramatic, not as fun. But to have, like, especially if you have a great subwoofer and you have a great pair of speakers and you go out there and just jam on it, like, there's nothing better than that. And so let's say you're working on, like, I've been working on the E36 doing the suspension for the last 2 days. I'm probably 8 or 9 hours into messing around with it. And, you know, I've been able to listen to podcasts without just doing some goofy headphones. And also then turning on some music and just letting it rip. It's just a better experience in the garage when you have great audio. So I think I would rather have a better audio system. If I had to choose between having an audio system in my house somewhere or in the garage, 100% choose the garage. Because you're just not gonna listen to audio music as much in the house as you would in the garage, I think. So even though the garage is probably the worst room to listen to it in, I think that the garage is the most fun, the most enjoying place. I get the most enjoyment out of listening to music in the garage. Other questions?
All right, this one is from Shaz29. I don't have enough outlets in my garage. Would going to emits instead of LYD be a step down?
Okay, no, absolutely not. So emits are basically an LYD without an amplifier. And actually an emit with a great amplifier is gonna sound better than an LYD for sure.
Drew wants to know, are there any AM3s going on sale? Just found the live stream here.
Yes. Yeah, AM3s, all that stuff is on sale as well, or will be on sale. We'll get into those. We'll dig into those. I would suggest you hang out and wait. I'll give you all my thoughts on the differences between the two when we do that on next Tuesday. Next Tuesday at 5 p.m. And by the way, these videos are all going to be, you're going to stay up on the channel. So if you didn't catch it live, you're watching now and it wasn't live, you can still hit us up and we'll take care of you. We're gonna run this sale through probably like August 12th or something like that. So let me get checked back in with Brad here and talk about where do people go. So how are people checking in on the sale if there's some new people that just joined the stream?
So you've got two options. You can go to, right here in the chat on the right side, you'll see an open box deals link. And so that link will take you to a spreadsheet that has all the different open box, all the things that Matt's using right now. And so you can email us, Nick and I, support@obsessedgarage.com, and you can access any of those. You'll see some strike throughs. Those have already been sold. Anything that's not struck through, you can still get from us, open box. And in addition to that, anything that we sell in the audio collection is 20% off for the duration of this live stream. So someone was asking about AM3s. If you want some AM3s, just go on the site, add them to your cart. The discount will apply in your cart. So it's not on the page itself, it'll be in your cart. So anything that you want, audio, any package,
Right, it doesn't have to be just studio monitors. Tonight we're talking studio monitors. It can be anything. And,
right.
And most of the stuff we have in stock, if we don't have it in stock, we have more stock coming, so we can oversell.
So you can, yeah, you can order anything that we have, and you'll be able to get 20% off right there in your cart.
So if it goes to RYS or Reserve Your Spot, that means we sold out of what we have in stock. But it won't be long. Most of the stuff is available. We'll kind of keep you up to date with where stuff is.
Right.
But don't be afraid to overbuy if it's Reserve Your Spot, because we're going to be ordering more stuff as needed.
Hex Plus? What is the deal with Hex Plus?
Yeah, so if you are a Hex Plus member, you will be getting free shipping, just like you always do on any of this stuff. And if you are not Hex Plus, you do not get free shipping on even the open box stuff. So you will be paying shipping on open box stuff. So Hex Plus, free shipping, like always. Not Hex Plus. No free shipping.
Other questions, Chris?
Nope, not at the moment.
Okay. All right, so let's dig into some more practical stuff. Remember, we're starting at the top, working our way down. All the same principles apply, right? The connections on LYDs are the same. The same near-field concept of a studio monitor in the garage and lots of control is still the same. There's actually four different LYDs, or there's only three different cores. I don't carry the LYD 7. I think it's inferior. You would want the LYD 8 for a few hundred bucks more. But we have LYD 48s, and the Dyna Audio guys call it LUD. I think that sounds stupid. I like calling it LYD. So LYD 48s are the single 7-inch driver, single 3-inch woofer, and then 1-inch tweeter. Different drivers, so these are not of the same ilk as the core stuff, so less expensive. The cabinets are not the same, as you notice. These are, you know, just simple MDF with a wood veneer over it, or like a wrapped veneer on them. The faceplate is a gloss painted, either gloss black or gloss, I guess it's sort of a semi-gloss, more of like a matte type finish. What would it be? I guess it'd be like eggshell almost. So there's a little bit of a sheen to it, but it has a painted surface on the front baffle here. And all of these come in either white or black. When we say white, the back of the cabinet is still black, but the faceplate is white. So if you were to get an LYD-8 in white, just this faceplate would be white. If you were to get LYDs in white, then just the face is white. The other thing I didn't mention is when you're buying studio monitors, they're sold individually. So they're sold as singles. So when you go look at the pricing, that's for one, not for a pair. It says that very clearly in the in the description of the products, but I figured I'd mention that. So these are different. You know, these I believe the core stuff is made in Denmark. Let me see, they usually tell us on the back. Yeah, so made in Denmark. The LYD stuff is made in China. Now, let's see here. Oh, no, I'm wrong. Made in Denmark. So I guess that's not a big selling point. But the cabinets are very different. The port on the LYD stuff is on the back, not the front. I don't think that really matters much. Even if you put it up next to a wall, what you can do is you can choose your setting here and just put it wall, and the DSP will help overcome that. But you can see the fit and finish of a LYD is not of the same ilk. Now, we're talking about, Jeff, what are my prices on these? What's an LYD 48 for somebody? So these are $1,149 each. What's the math on that? $2,300 bucks a pair? Yeah, so $2,300 a pair, LYD 8s.
LYD 8s are $789.
So they're $1,600 a pair. And then LYD 5s.
$499 a pair.
So these are $1,000 bucks a pair. So $2,300, $1,600, and $1,000. Thank you. So, and I have these on a, I'll talk about this in a minute, but I have these on a acoustic, isoacoustic stand, which these guys keep telling me no, you can't sell them. No, this doesn't make any sense. So someday I'll get them, but they're the best decoupling stands on the market. I think they're great. I have them all over the place. So LYD 8s, pull up my spec on these LED 48s and 8s. So what's the, so this is the same class D. It's not a Pascal class D, but I believe the woofers are 75 watts, and the tweeters are 50 watts. Help me out with this, Jeff. So LED 48 has a three-channel amplifier on the on this. Two. Say what? 50 for the tweeter, 50 for the mid-bass driver, and 80 for the woofer. And so on the LYD 7, part of the reason why we don't carry the 7, the LYD 7 is a 7-inch woofer, and I believe it has less power as well, if you look at the 7. So 50 watts for the tweeter, 80 watts for the woofer. So compare that to the cores, which is 500 and 150. So pretty significant output difference.
Yeah, the 7 is 50.
Yeah, see, this is 80 and 50. The LYD 7 has an inferior amplifier and a smaller woofer in pretty much the same box. So we can order LYD 7s for you if you'd want, but I think you do LYD 8s. So to me, these are the garage speakers. This is like the bread and butter. This is the, you know, this is like the speaker that you buy in the mid-tier. I don't have an entry tier yet in studio monitors. If we're doing entry, we're gonna go to PSB stuff. But these are the speakers that I think, you know, everybody should buy. You know, you should save your pennies, put this together, get yourself a Blue Sound node. You could do a C685. I don't think it's necessary. I don't think it's worth it to me to do this, unless you have a really echoey, really crappy sounding garage, you'd want this for Dirac. But I think you do a Blue Sound node, which is an amazing processor, amazing streaming device, and you do a pair of, you know, either one of these, whichever one you can pony up the cash for. You know, if you can afford the extra $700, go to LYD 48s. This is what I had next door before we came over here to the Yarn Building. I had these before I was a Dyne Audio dealer. I've had this pair of speakers for, I don't know, it's ever since I started this. Since probably 2017, something like that. And that's when I fell in love with the concept of a studio monitor as a speaker in the garage. So, setup is the same. The difference is these actually have an RCA connection. So if you didn't want to buy a pair of cables, you could throw an RCA cable on here. So technically speaking, you could come right out of the Blue Sound node, write RCA to RCA and make it simple. I like to run XLRs if I have the choice. It's just a more solid connection. Notice the DSP is not as sophisticated either. All I have, I simply have on, and then I have the ability to adjust the frequency here. So this is a, they call it bass extension. If you listen to the speakers loud all the time, you wanna run it as minus 10 kilohertz. If you listen to them quiet, like for example, on my desk setup with the E5s, I run them at plus 10 dB. That way it shifts the frequency response at low volumes. So again, these are true, you know, inexpensive studio monitors in the world of studio monitors. These are pretty cheap. But in the garage, I'm generally just going to run it in the middle. I'm going to run it dark. Same thing. I'm going to run the others, and I'm going to run it free unless I have it butted up against the wall. I'd switch the DSP to wall. And then all I'm going to do, simple XLR connection. So these take even less time to set up because you have less choice of which switches to turn. By the way, we have very specific videos on the product pages where I go into exactly how to set this stuff up if I'm moving too fast for you. So that's connected and on. This one, connected and on. Set it to free, set it to dark, set it to zero. Oh, there's also a sensitivity, which you can run. I think I run them at plus 6 dB on these. Yeah, plus 60 dB is a sensitivity. And then I have it on auto standby mode. So now, Node. Node will use the exact same software, the exact same Blue OS software as I was using on the N80-685. One of the differences here, I'm gonna add these pigtails. Because this doesn't have XLR out, I'm gonna connect to the left and right output. If you were to buy a package, you know, we sell all the stuff in packages, or you can just buy this. We'll get all the cables to you and everything that you need. And so then I take my XLR, which I have set up here, and I plug in. Now, the benefit to this, the benefit of an XLR cable is the grounding pin. So it helps with noise and hum and stuff like that. I'm basically rendering that useless because I'm coming out RCA. So there's no real benefit. There's no audio performance benefit of running RCA to XLR like I'm doing, other than I have lots of XLR cables. XLR cables aren't any more than RCA cables, and it's a more solid connection on the LYD48s. So let's power this up. The Blue Sound does have the ability to change volume and things on top, but this isn't a thing that you're never going to touch. You're never going to touch the thing. You're going to go into your Blue OS app. I'm going to go to my home screen. So there it is. This was actually in my house. So Darlington Garage Node. Let's make sure we go in here to audio settings. And we're going to turn our subwoofer off because we don't have a subwoofer connected at the moment. My tone controls are off, so I'm just running normal flat volume. So audio clock trim, I don't want that. Oh no, I do want that. Interesting. That's a new software update. It says Blue OS uses small adjustments to the audio clock to maintain glitch-free synchronization. Interesting. I don't know what that means. So let's go make sure we're logged into Tidal, and we are. Let's play some Perfect Circle. Gosh, I haven't listened to these in so long. But these were my rock stars in the garage for at least 3 years. So, this is an instance where you could very easily run these without a subwoofer. You could run these without a subwoofer. You can run these without a subwoofer. I'm not buying these for my garage. You know, they're just, I mean, these to me are desktop speakers. These are speakers for my desk. You could buy these for the garage. I'd rather see you do something else, do some other setup like some PSB, P5s. But with LYD, I think a path for LYD stuff is to get these and then kind of work your way into a subwoofer later. You know, work your way into an SVS subwoofer. A perfect SVS combo with these would be like an SB2000 or PB2000 with these. You know, so a $900 or $1,100 subwoofer would be really incredible with this setup. You know, so if you're, you know, let's say you're $2,300 for the speakers, $1,000 or $900 of that, so you're $3,200, and then you buy yourself, a $900 subwoofer, so you're $4,100. But you can kind of piece that together. You can add the subwoofer later, or knock, you know, $700 off of that, and now you're in the $3,500 range for like a world-class audio system in your garage. Now, again, when we get into the stereo, the passive systems, we're going to get into the $1,000, $1,500, that $2,000 and less systems. But in the studio monitor realm right now, to do a really quality setup, you know, you're somewhere around $3,000 to $5,000, you know, to do it in the LYD range. So the big difference audibly that you're going to hear between these two, I feel like these are fuller, the separate mid-range. the ability to play a few hertz down, but it's going to be the same story that you have in the cores, where you have this. They all sound the same. It's just more. These have more output, more amplitude, more capability. They sound a little fuller because they do have a separate mid range. But if you didn't have the two side by side to A/B compare, I don't think you'd hear much of a difference. Any questions coming in, Chris?
Yes, we have a question from Jason. He has KRK Rocket 8-inch monitors.
Okay.
Wants to know what self-powered studio monitors does Matt have that compare to those? He's looking to replace.
Yeah, so I mean that's what we're talking about. So these are self-powered studio monitors. So either LYDs or, you know, I have cores that we just talked about. But I think a good replacement for that would probably be LYD-8s, $1,600. If he already has a device to connect to them, they have XLR in, so you could connect to that. But again, I think the combo is to do a Blue Sound node and then a pair of LYD-8s.
All right, this is from S2G37. Really going back and forth between AM5s and node and LYD-5s and node.
Yep.
Any opinions on difference to listening experience and setup / user experience?
One of the problems with AM5 and Node is you can't do MQA. So you won't be able to do master quality audio and title, where you will be able to on LYDs. AM5s are going to be a little bit more, you're going to have a little bit more amplitude, I think. But I would pick LYDs, absolutely. But you're talking about a pretty significant price difference, you know, $500 more. So if you have an extra $500, LYD-5s would be the way to go. You know?
Like Kyle Webb in the chat says, do you use a pair of LYD-5s with a PC? I've seen Matt use the UA interface.
Yes.
How are they connected, though? Is it RCA out from the interface and then an RCA to XLR adapter?
No. So what you do is you need to do a TRS, which is like a guitar or like a quarter inch. It's a quarter inch male headphone jack, basically, big fat med headphone jack. And so Sweetwater has them, but you do TRS to XLR. So they sell a cable. You generally want a 10-foot cable. So the 10-foot Mogami ones they have there, I think they're like $60 a pair. And so you go TRS to XLR, and I think it's XLR male is what you're getting, is what this end is. And so we're eventually going to have those. I just don't have anybody that makes them. Like Mogami wouldn't just sell me those cables. They can't make enough for their current customers, so they wouldn't add me. But yeah, we'll show you in a minute. We'll talk about it.
That was big.
That was like hitting the building. Like I felt that. Is everything still working?
Oh man,
we're still live. How are we still live? The building almost blew up. What does it look like out there? It's Armageddon. God dang. I felt that like my whole hair stood up on my head. We're still here, people, I think.
Quick subwoofer question from Shaz29. SVS SV3000 versus SVS 3000 Micro. What is the difference? I got a 2 or 3 car garage. Which would be preferred?
Yeah, definitely SV3000. The Micro is really a good desk subwoofer. You know, the Micro is, and there's no question there. I'm gonna get into the Micro. I'll make a Micro video coming up here soon. But yeah, definitely SV3000. Just completely different amplitude output. Not even close. I mean, the Micro is a little modern marvel, but not something that can compare.
Ian wants to know, did I hear Matt is a dealer for Sennheiser?
Yes.
I'm in the market for the Ambio.
Yes.
If so, does this discount apply for that as well? We don't currently have them in the store. So.
Well, we can order them tomorrow. I have it in a week. Email us and we'll figure that out. I need to order those. That Ambio is absolutely incredible. Absolutely. I'm going to be questioning, I think I'd rather still have a pair of LYDs in this setup, but an Ambio can skip all this. So an Ambio is $2,500. It has full room calibration. You don't need a node. You don't need a, now you'd be air playing, you wouldn't have full high res audio, but I'm telling you, that thing is absolutely incredible. It destroys my giant family room at my house. So, the other cool thing about the Ambio is they're gonna be launching an Ambio Lite. I don't know if they're gonna call it that, but an Ambio that's half the price. And they're gonna be launching an Ambio subwoofer too, which would connect wirelessly right to it, right through the software. It's gonna be sick. But the Ambio is $2,500 right now. That thing weighs like 100 pounds. It's crazy. It's by far the best, what do you call it, soundbar on the planet. No question. Nothing else can touch it. It's so much better than anything else.
Solarplex Studios wants to know, do they still make Dynaudio ZO20s?
ZO20s are officially discontinued. The ZO20s are from Dynaudio. They are wireless. The deficiency of them has been they are wireless, but it's Bluetooth wireless. And their connectivity, so their connectivity to high-res audio solutions is not good. And they also are really problematic to connect to a subwoofer. And so what you would do is you would add a node to them. But, you know, what are they, $2,500 a pair? And you need, I think they're more than that.
They're $2,500 a pair. Are the Z10s discontinued as well?
Z10, Z20s are both being discontinued, being replaced by the Fusion.
So we still have some.
Yeah, so if you want them, they are amazing, though. For a wireless speaker, the sound quality of them is amazing. But, yeah, they've discontinued Zio stuff.
That's on day three, right?
Hmm?
Yeah,
so that will be, we'll dig into Zios and AM5s on day three, which would be Tuesday at 5 p.m. next week, August 9th. We'll be digging into those very specifically.
That's all the questions for now.
Okay. So, subwoofers for these. This is where I think SVS, this is where I'm excited for the SVS stuff. So, the Dynaudio Sub 9S sucks. It's great for your desk, that's it. Small room, small office under your desk, and I think I'm gonna be replacing that with the Micro, the SVS Micro, this little guy. So these are dual eights, single nine. I just don't know why Dynaudio didn't put the high excursion woofer. It sounds really good, but it doesn't have a whole heck of a lot of output. Or this are two high excursion 8-inch woofers, so 16 inches of air is moving in the Micro. The size is very similar. I've never put these next to each other. Dang, they are like spot on. Same width. Same box. Same exact footprint. I don't like that the Micro is glossy. I forget if there's, I think there's a white version of this. Since we're talking about this, let's talk about the desk setup. I hands down would highly, highly recommend if you're setting up a desk, you do this. 3000 Micro will have these in stock in a couple of weeks. You do LED5s. You do the isoacoustic stands. We're gonna fight. I'm gonna try to get some sort of audio interface, but you need an interface to connect to the XLR connection on the back. And so to come out of your PC, you would come out, or your PC or your MacBook, or your, you know, one of your Mac in general, you'd come out USB-C or Thunderbolt into the device that I've been buying right now is the Universal Audio Volt 176. It's $180. The one I have over here is the $700 Solo. The problem with the Universal Audio Solo is that you need a stupid software that messes up your whole computer. It's terrible, terrible software. And then next door, I have what's that other Sennheiser or that Universal Audio I have? It's the Apollo Twin. You know, we're not doing like guitar solos here where I need some audio processing. So I was just using it just to turn the volume up and down. The advantage of the Twin X stuff is the software, the processor. It does pass 24/192, but I think the Volt does the same thing. And the Volt's $180. They just came out with it. And you don't need any software for it. It just connects to your computer and just works. And you can run a microphone through it and stuff like that too. And so think about, you have the Volt. So a little box looks like this. But you have a little box. And then you would play all your music through your laptop or through your, you know, computer instead of through, you know, your phone. And then you would run a TRS into... Actually, this is a bit problematic. I'm gonna have to figure this out. because this only has RCA in. I'm pretty sure they would make a TRS to RCA cable, and then you would just come RCA out and go RCA into your LYD5s. Because the advantage of running the Sub9S with your LYD5s is that the DSP is done, the processing is done here, the crossing over is done in the subwoofer, because this guy has XLR in, XLR out. And you set your satellite crossover here, and that's the best way to set it up. So this does have some superiority in connectivity to your LYD5s. But we're going to build a whole desk system. We're going to have desks on our site, on a Destination OG and all that, so that stuff is coming. But you can always email me, matt@obsessedgarage.com, and I'm always happy to help you out, figure out your desk setup. But I'm telling you, a set of LYD5s. Now, I have the Sub18S under my desk. But I'm an audio baller, audio hoarder, audio crazy person. Plus, I get a much bigger discount than you're getting on these, so that's another reason why. Other questions before I get into cables?
I need to circle back here to Mark Ward. He saw this, I guess, on our open box. So he wants to know, SVS Prime Satellite 2-pack, white gloss,
yep.
Is that good for a set of computer speakers?
It will work. And if your room is... if you have lots of fabric and lots of furniture and stuff in the room, the SVS speakers I don't love because they're aluminum dome. So if you most males have a difficult time hearing high frequencies. So most males like a brighter speaker. If you know that you like a bright speaker, or if you know that you don't like a bright speaker, don't buy them. But yeah, the primes are nice. They're nice. I would rather have PSBs. PSBs, because of their ferrofluid cooled surround, as well as their waveguide that's on the front of their aluminum dome tweeter, it sounds almost like a Dynaudio silk dome. Not quite, but almost like it.
One more before we get to wires here from Philip Z. What's your choice of Dynaudio wireless speaker for everyday use, like around the house, at the beach, etc.?
Yeah, you'd want a music, which you can't get. And Dynaudio musics are awesome. It's a little, little Bluetooth speaker, a little, the Music 3 is what I carry around. The Music 3 is amazing. It's like $600? But we haven't been able to get them, and they haven't had any guidance. We're bringing in some Dolly. Dolly is another brand of a Bluetooth speaker, a little wireless speaker that we're bringing in to test out. The Dolly stuff uses BlueOS, and the Dolly stuff also has a silk dome tweeter. They're made in Denmark just like these, so it might be a nice alternative. I think it's called I forget what the name is, called Rubicon or something like that.
Quick compliment for you here, boost your ego a little, from Jeffrey Watson. Wanted to say thank you. Just found your videos a month ago, and it has started to make me think differently. Bought a pressure washer package, and wow, what a different experience.
Thanks, I appreciate Jeffrey. That. Cool. We're trying to change the world here, doing some fun stuff.
All right, now let me lead you through this.
Okay.
Volt 176.
Yep.
To Mogami TRS XLR wires.
Yep.
To Dynaudio 18S.
Yep.
To XLR to LYD5. Does that look right for my desk?
Correct. There you go. Correct. So you'd have like a 2-meter XLR cable, just like we've been using here. So one of these guys. You just need a TRS, so the TRS cable. So the TRS cable has the plug, and then it has the headphone thingy, the quarter-inch guitar-type connection, and then has XLRs, and the XLRs go into the back of the 9S or the 18S. And then you would have a separate XLR cable, one of these, that goes up to your speaker, to your LYD5s. We got to create a package for this because it's awesome. So when we're dealing with cables here, for all of these studio monitors, there's really only two possible cables you might want. So XLRs, so 1 meter, 2 meter, 4 meter, 6 meter, which is 19.7 feet. So these are sort of the higher end Velux cables from Metra. The 4 meter and 6 meter I had custom made because they didn't exist. You might need, just disconnect this, twist it off. You might need one of these jumpers if you're going to use a node. You might need the jumpers as well if you were going to do a... What the heck's going on here? So you might need one of these little guys, which are... The only company I can find that makes these are Monoprice and Mogami. And so these are hard to find. So this is a pretty inexpensive little thing, $7 or $8, something like that. And then we have Monoprice make me a 25-foot and a 35-foot if we needed something longer. So three feet, 6 feet, 13 feet, 19 or 20 feet, 25 feet, 35 feet. So we have all these different size cables depending on what you need. You might need the 35-footer for a subwoofer. If you need us to order something else or to recommend to you, we can order 50 feet, 100 feet, whatever you need to do. You could run XLRs a couple hundred feet and it'll still work well without any degradation. So you will need those cables for various connections. This really, the beauty of this setup, these things are super simple. You'd have three different cables, you know, in your whole system. Now, let's talk about subwoofer connection wirelessly, and then we'll wrap up for tonight. So if I want to connect wirelessly, and we'll have some SVS stuff coming soon. The SVS is superior to the one that we've been doing, the OSD audio. What the heck did I do with that thing? Oh, it's over here. So if we're going to connect a subwoofer to the system and we don't have the real ability to run the wires, we could run this. And so we have a, this is the receiver version. No, this is the transmitter, sorry. That's the transmitter, and this is the receiver. So this is from a company called OSD Audio, really simple, cheap, you know, it's like $150 or something like that. We'll be bringing in the SVS ones once we sell through these. But all you would do to connect this, and we sell these specifically for this task, is I like to run Y adapters on this. You don't need to run a Y adapter, but nobody sells a little short RCA whip. And so it's easier to just do a wide adapter, and theoretically there'd be a little bit of performance bump from, you know, splitting the signal down, you know, from mono to stereo, I guess. I don't know. Anyway, it's all going to be mono anyway. So what we're going to do, let's say we're setting up our blue sound node. Same would hold true for the C685. I'm going to come out of the subwoofer connection here. Coming out of the subwoofer output, which is right there. And I'm going to go like this with my RCA connection. And then I'm going to take and I'm going to plug in. So this is, think of your subwoofer signal. So subwoofer wired out. And my wire all wonky here. You get the idea. What's going on here? It's going to drive me crazy. So you go subwoofer out of the node into the transmitter. Transmitter, I could take my subwoofer, take it 20 feet away, 30 feet away, 50 feet away. The only thing that becomes problematic is if your node was in a cabinet. I'd always suggest you take the node, put the node on top of a cabinet. If you put it in the cabinet, you're trying to do anything wirelessly, you're going to have issues. It's just not going to work very well. And then I take another one of these, so let's just pretend so I don't have to open this up. So I'm going to take and have another one of these. Let's say on my sub-18S, say I was connecting this, or I was connecting one of my SVS subwoofers or anything. I'm going to come to the single subwoofer output on the receiver, and I'm going to go right in, left in. And now I have a wireless connection. You can kind of tack this to the back of the speaker. This actually in the box comes with a little clip that you can screw to the back and then clip this on. And then you just kind of tuck this in place. Now these do need separate power, so this has to be plugged into the wall or plugged into the outlet. And so generally I'd have this plugged and my subwoofer plugged in. And that's all you need to do for your wireless subwoofer connection. So no different than running an XLR cable like I have for my core sub here. The frequency response, this is down to 18 hertz. So if you're running a core sub, I would highly suggest let's figure out how to wire it. Or we'll get you in the new SVS tri-band, which plays down to like 6 hertz or something like that. It will pass full frequency response. So that's how you do your wireless setup. You don't have to do anything in the settings or anything, and it'll connect real time. and save you the pain of having to try to connect your subwoofer with a giant long cable. So that's how you do a wireless setup. So really, you got a couple of cables, you got a wireless option. We do have packages for all these to make it simple, where it comes with everything. You know, if you're doing your speakers, like if you're doing the DynAudio, like these, I would suggest, you got to get this on Amazon, but again, isoacoustic stands are what you want. So isoacoustics, they won't let me sell it yet, but at some point, hopefully. And then I usually add like a little pitch, either up or downward. But this has a up to 4 degree or 6 degree angle or something like that. It'll allow you to angle down if you had them here, like you'd want to angle up. If you were sitting at your desk, you'd want to angle up towards your listening position. If you're up high on your cabinets, you'd want to angle down. Other questions? Before we wrap up tonight.
Wants to know, what's the top subwoofer pick to pair with an LYD-8?
LYD-8, I would want either a sub-18S, which is $1,800. Another option would be a SB or PB-3000. Where's the PB-3000? Look at this thing. You got to have the room for this. That's a PB-3000. PB-3000 is $1,600. $1,600 for the sub, $1,600 for the speaker. Or you could do an SB-3000, less than half the size. So SB-3000 is $1,100. So it's 1,800 for an 18S would be my top pick. I would rather have this than that. I love this subwoofer. But the output of this is not even close to that. You know, the output of this giant ported monster. You have to have the room for this. If you don't have the jack, really, I think the best complement for an LYD-8 would probably be an SV-2000. That's my favorite subwoofer in the whole line of SVS. The 3000 is a 13-inch woofer and an 800-watt amplifier. The 2000 has a 12-inch woofer and a 550-watt amplifier. But I'm telling you, the 2000, I think, is the sweet spot for subwoofers with SVS. So put that combination together and you will have a destroy the whole garage. Just amazing. For what, $1,600, $900 for the SB2000 and a Blue Sound node, and you've got yourself a world-class garage system. World-class. Krenzler-level garage system. You know, the core stuff is like buying a Krenzler KWS 700, which you just don't need. And in many ways, the loudness and the bulkiness of the Krenzler KWS 700, the bulkiness of the core stuff, you got to have the right garage for that. And so I think, that combination of LYD-8s, very, very practical. Of course, I'd rather have 48s because they're horizontal. I think they look a little better in the garage. But LYD-8s is like the sweet spot for audio setup with an SB-2000. Would be awesome. Just really, really, really awesome. The SB-2000 is right here. I got speakers coming out my orifices. So that's the SB-2000. This thing's great. Ouch. Sealed, small, compact, plays down to like 16 hertz or something like that. Killer subwoofer. So you can see it's considerably smaller than the SB-3000. Put that with a pair of LYD-8s. Love it. Other questions?
When are the SVS subs going live for sale?
We're a couple weeks out. We got to order them in bulk. I'm hoping to raise some money on these audio sales and order them. And we're probably not going to stock the 4000s and the Ultras. They're just too big to ship. And so we'll just miss out on that, or just special order for those who really want to support us. I've been getting it figured out. We've been listening a lot to them, and so we'll have them available here shortly.
Jason Taylor wants to know, what is that thing that you're showing, the wireless adapter?
It's called OSD Audio. It's called the Nero. to $114 or something, $140, something like that. We have it in the store.
All right, one more question here from Shaz29. I already have a sealed SVS SB16 Ultra.
Okay.
But I'm questioning if I should get another SB16, upgrade to two Dynaudio 18Ss, or upgrade to two SVS PB16 Ultras. It's 50-50 mix of music and TV in a very large room.
You would do sub sixes, not sub 18S. So sub six is about the same price as an Ultra, like an PB16 Ultra. That's the monster. That's the monster SVS. The quality of sound you'd get out of a pair of sub sixes, and the fact that the sucker is this big, the amplitude and output you're going to get, and the perceived, you know, hit you in the face is not even close. A couple of Ultras, any of the Ultras, any really, even like an SB3000 or PB3000 is going to destroy this in amplitude. But in just pure quality, I don't know how to explain it. Just to put it into perspective, I can get any of these, and I get them all dirt cheap, and they want me to own all of them. I have two sub sixes in both of my theaters, one in Helen and the one in my house here. So I have these set up, the sub six with my Contour 60 is the big giant, you know, $15,000 set of Dynaudios. If it's a giant room and it's a theater and you really enjoy that fun factor, I mean, I think the Ultras would probably be your preference. Musically, these will destroy the Ultras. Movie-wise, the fun factor of it, these might bore you a bit if you're used to that kind of in-your-face bass experience. But there's something about the way these things hit when they hit, when you're watching a movie, it's hard to explain. So for me, but I'm looking for gentleman spec. I like bass, but I want gentleman bass. So, but it's hard to beat the value of $2,500 for a you know, PB16 Ultra. I think I'd be inclined to keep the one you have and just add another one to it. He has the SB16 is what he has.
SB16 Ultra.
Yeah, I would just buy another one of those and be good to go. That's what I would do 100%. As long as you got the room to fit it, I mean, why not use the one you have? You might be disappointed. These might bore you a little bit in comparison. So that's a wrap. We're gonna do more of this kind of stuff if you guys like it. We're trying it. It's a freaking rainstorm. It's probably messed up our audio the whole time, but luckily the mic's right here. Go to, hit up support at obsessedgarage.com. You can continue to shoot them an email for the foreseeable future here in the next week or two. And you can go to the links in this description or in the comments to look at the remaining open box stuff we have. So we probably still have a pair of Core 47s, LID8s, LID48s. The LID5s we don't have because those are mine from my desk, and the sub 18S, but those are all still 20% off. I got a bunch of 18Ss in stock. So if you're interested in any of this stuff, it's super helpful if you support us and buy it, and we'll get it shipped out to you as soon as possible. If there's something that shows out of stock, just means that we sold too much, and we'll have more coming. So I appreciate you. Just place the order, and that'll light a fire on us to go get it done and get it ordered from Dynaudio or NAD or wherever. So anyway, thanks for your support. We'll see you on Friday at 2 p.m., a normal podcast time, and we'll be talking about some impractical and even more practical solutions than the LYD stuff with the addition of PSB. So we'll be talking about Dynaudio, I'll probably bring my Entity M33 over here, and we'll be breaking out different amplifiers like the power node and things like that to be discussing how to do it. So appreciate your support, and we'll see you later this week. Thanks for watching.